winning at home, they're still well placed to make Division 3. Wolves, Cardiff and Orient all dropped vital points over the weekend.
Still only draw, despite a sensational opening few minutes.
The game started with a flurry of niggly play and Hartlepool's Paul Baker was sent off in the fourth minute after kicking Phil Lloyd. Just 6 minutes later, Torquay used their one-man advantage as Mark Loram held off two challenges and set up Alan Pearce, who ran in unchallenged, to put them a goal up. Hartlepool's 10 men started the second half looking more determined than Torquay, with John Borthwick and Tony Barrett outstanding. Borthwick's cross nearly brought a goal for Barrett. And despite some near misses at the other end, it was no great surprise when the Pool got their equaliser. The Torquay defence lost a couple of challenges and the loose ball fell nicely for Tony Barrett to score. It almost looked as if it was Torquay down to 10 men, and that certainly seemed to be the reaction of Kenny Allen in the Torquay goal. Several chances for Torquay to win it, but their home form is making promotion chances harder than they might be. Even so, both these teams could well be involved in the shakedown for promotion or playoffs in May.
Let's hope Torquay are up there with the rest of them. Craig, is it time they could lose their manager? Dick?
Well, hardly the best preparation for promotion, but those are the facts. Cyril Nels, the manager, makes no secret of the fact that he wants to manage a first or second division club. And whereas promotion for Torquay would help his CV no end, yesterday's ban for 8 matches on striker Dave Caldwell was a shattering blow.
It's sad, really. It's sad how it's all happened and that. I mean, I think he's done marvellous, really, the kid, for Torquay, since he's come. And I'm sitting down this afternoon with my chairman and we're going to go through it and just see what we can come up with, David, as well.
It is a pretty incredible record, yeah. 5 sendings off.
Is.
And yet, if you take, for instance, the Wolves game, he takes a fair amount of provocation, the lad.
He does. You know, I feel the one he got sent off was down at Aldershot, his last one. I think possibly the managers are winding some of the defenders up. And I know David nearly got took off by the Ips after 2 minutes down at Aldershot. And he got booked for an handball and a skirmish with a centre-half 10 minutes later and was sent off.
He's got to be a bit shattered. He was even talking about giving the game up, wasn't he?
Well, that's right. I mean, what'll happen in the future? I mean, if he gets booked, do I pull him off straight away? If I leave him on and he gets another booking and gets sent off, what could be the sentence? I mean, he's had 8 games now. It could be 12, 15 games. You know, I mean, it's worrying.
Unsettling, too, for the fans. Not only are they going to lose one of their favourites, but also speculation all the time about yourself. You made no secret of the fact you're an ambitious man.
I am ambitious. I want to have a go at the top. You know.
And realistically, you can't see Torquay being able to go that far?
Well, I don't know. I don't know if I've got that much time.
Well, as it happens, tomorrow's match against Peterborough is the immediate doubt. There'll be a pitch inspection tomorrow morning at 11 o'clock. I think it's a bit touch and go. Well, still in the fourth division, Exeter City are due to play...
I think shot was one of the few highlights of the first half, together with a fine header from Jim McNichol from the cross by Tom Kelly. But the combination of some dour defence by Peterborough and a skating rink of a pitch proved too much for a Torquay side desperate to win their first league game at home since November. Well, thankfully, United's bad boy Dave Caldwell kept a cool head, which should stand him in good stead for the club's appeal against his 8-match ban. Unfortunately, much of the crowd drifted away well before the end, and they missed Torquay's purple patch. Mark Loram did beautifully here, but David Cole didn't make the best of his height advantage. But it was Dave Cobble himself who fluffed the easiest chance towards the end in pouring rain. For Torquay, certainly a case of 2 wasted points.
They've come today, Peterborough, and just stopped us from playing. And I think teams are doing that now. They're looking at us and I think they're just trying to stop us from playing. I mean, they were content with the point. They seemed happy the way they were time-wasting and things like that. But, you know, we've got to put up with this. It is sad when you look at his away record, where we've had 10 away wins.
It must be second only to Liverpool, I would think.
It's fantastic, you know, and I'd settle to play away now all his home games. But it's just one of those things. It's an unfortunate thing, you know. We don't seem to be able to do it at home at the moment, although we're not losing, and nobody's running away with it, probably only Wolves. But, you know, we'll stick in there and see what happens.
It is a real mystery. On our basketball,
this weekend, they took on Cardiff at Plainmoor.
So the free kick in, and left there by Kenny Allen, and that could have been a goal by Terry Boyle. Well, Allen won't be too happy with that. So the corner for Cardiff. Curtis, not to the middle, and that's a good shot. And Allen goes for it again, and in the end, it's McNichol who has to knock it away. 28 minutes gone, Lauren with the corner, and it's another bad effort. Well, that seemed to have been over the line. In fact, the referee is pointing to the spot. It looked as though it was handball. Cardiff are dissenting, and it seems the referee has awarded the penalty. The penalty then for handball to be taken by Lee Sharp. And it's there. Torquay United in the lead after 31 minutes play. In by Tom Kelly to Alan Pearce, gets the return. Loram, nice shield there, and that should leave Kelly to knock the ball into the centre, and a lovely goal! Jim McNichol, superb move there by Torquay. Lovely interchange between Tom Kelly and Alan Pearce. Kelly picked it up, hit a splendid cross into the middle, and there was McNichol on that far post where he loves to be, super header. So, 36 minutes gone here at Plainmoor. It's Torquay United 2, Cardiff 0. Bartlett with the lob and just wide. Not Kelly then for Cardiff, and a good effort too. Kelly Allen had it covered, but not far off the target. And the whistle blows. Well, a very disappointing second half for Torquay, but even so, that's a convincing scoreline over Cardiff. And 3 points, which of course will put them right back into that promotion frame. Score here at Plainmoor, Torquay United 2, Cardiff 0.
Meanwhile, at the Huish, Yeovil cruise to victory over League
League. Overcome promotion jitters.
United made a slightly nervous start with Kenny Allen unable to hold on to this free kick, but Tom Kelly blocked the shot. And then Phil Lloyd almost gave Kevin Bartlett a shooting chance. But Torquay were to settle down and in the 32nd minute won a penalty. But Cardiff disputed that McDermott had handled, and Mike Ford was booked for the protesting, which meant that 16-year-old Lee Sharp, a YTS lad, had to wait before taking his first league penalty and score his first league goal. Just over 3,000 paid to watch. More must come to see goals of this quality. 37 minutes gone. Kelly Loram, Kelly again. A great goal for Jim McNichol. Fine save coming up from Kenny Allen to keep Torquay 2-0 up. Torquay defended well. It took an agricultural tackle on Dave Caldwell to stop them scoring again. Out of defence from a corner, Derek Dawkins fed Caldwell, and Nicky Plattenauer climbed all over him and picked up a booking. But the only booking Torquay fans are talking about now is United's place in next season's third division.
Yes, I'm sure they're going to make it. Good old Torquay.
United taking the lead from this penalty. The ball there handled on the line. And it's Lee Sharp tucking it away. He really is a superb player, this YTS youngster, who's beginning to look a real find for Torquay. The lovely goal coming up for Torquay's second. The cross by Tom Kelly. And there's Jim McNichol, well placed for his 8th goal of the season. You can see that again on the slow-mo. McNichol, of course, one of the few survivors from the side last year. So how does this present Torquay team compare?
This is probably the best side I've played in. The most organised team. You know, everybody knows their own jobs. You know, everybody knows what they're going to do at the time. And I think we should cop.
How much of that is down to Cyril Knowles?
I would say 90%. 90% of it. The gaffer's got us organised. He's got his plan, his system. It took us a wee while to get used to it, you know, a little bit different, but it's reaping the benefits now.
Certainly is. So, talking in action tonight at Plain.
Sharp's inside, and it's Colwell keeping possession very well indeed. Colwell may be unorthodox, but he's only on his way through. And ball there for Lee Sharp to chase, and he's won the battle with the fullback David Abrazy. It's the post! And Sharp really looking superb for him tonight. From Mark Gardner. Sharp meant that, but it's a lovely ball to Caldwell. And, in the end, the ball bobbing off the corner. Super cross there from Lee Sharp. Caldwell in the right place, but that effort deflected. And a needless corner there, given away by Newport County. So 5 minutes to go in this first half. Chance here for Torquay, surely. With the corner, that's he gets another chance, although it looks as though he'll never go out. A good time to score here, and knocked away by the goalkeeper to Shaw. Blams it! What a goal! Extraordinary! Lee Sharp gets his second. Well, at this rate, Torquay may well reconsider whether they want to sell him. I guess that was sheer magic. Well, the corner came over. Well, the corner came over from Pierce. It was knocked back. And Sharp hit that with tremendous ferocity. Right into the corner. Two goals for the young man. It's now Torquay 2, Newport 1. It's gone, Lee Sharp with the corner, Caldwell, and in the end cleared away, that could fall to McNichol, couldn't quite get his foot to it, so Sharp gets another chance here, on the right hand side this time, knocks it in, the dummy there, and that must be, yes, Paul Dobson, comes back in the side, on in the second half, substitute, and gives Torquay yet another goal in this match. Cross by Lee Sharp. Dobson really stabbed that one away. Yeah, Playmore, it's now Torquay United 3, Newport County 1. Chance here for Newport County at the corner in the second half. Knocked away by Lee Sharp. And number 8, Andy Thackeray, knocks it in straight into the arms of Kenny Allen. Jim McNichol. Surging run here, and that's the Gibbons, must score, yes! And Newport County now in complete disarray. Lovely ball by McNichol, but Gibbons knocking that one home. Torquay running right here at Playmore. Fourth goal, so now Torquay 4, Newport County 1. Kind of the monitor, isn't it?
Yeah.
So it's Caldwell again, and McNichol,
Not the chance to retrieve this. Sharp again, super ball. Must be, yes! Jim and Nicol, the scorer, but carved out by Lee Sharp, who's crowned a fantastic performance here this evening, and one which I'm sure all Torquay fans will talk about for a long time to come. But Nicol takes the credit, but Lee Sharp carving out that chance there. It's Torquay, their fifth goal here. It's now Torquay 5, Newport County 1. Torquay looking for number 6, Paul Dobson. Back to Sharp. Referee says play on, so Dobson does. And trips right on the edge of the area. Let's hope there's nothing serious there. So Sharp injured in that collision. And the header goes in again. Must be, yes. Hold up to him. It's number 6. 2 goals for the substitute. And Newport now shake their heads in disbelief as they're ripped apart by this Torquay side. There's still a quarter of an hour to go here at Playmore. It's now 6-1. Paul Dobson making a half dozen. Forward for Dobson. Over he goes. McNicol well placed there. Here at Playmore, a match which may well have ensured Torquay's place in the fourth division playoffs if other results have gone as planned. And look at the pitch invasion, because I think that the Torquay fans have seen a marvellous performance there from Lee Sharp, and one they won't forget in a hurry. Marvellous stuff here at Playmore. Final score, Torquay 6, Newport County 1.
At Playmore, about to happen to 16-year-old Lee Sharp of Torquay United.
Lee, who's still on a YTS training scheme at Playmore and earns just £25 a week, will move to Old Trafford at the end of the season in a deal thought to be worth around £50,000. Well, Manchester United have beaten off the challenge of a number of top clubs to sign the youngster, who's undoubtedly one of the most gifted players in the South West.
I was woke up at 1 o'clock. The boss and Dave Turner come round the house, got me out of bed at 1 o'clock and said, hey, do you fancy signing for Manchester United? I was just speechless. Couldn't believe it.
How long did it take to make up your mind?
Not very long. Not very long at all.
Lee's played an important part in United's promotion push. Well, this is best game to date in the recent 2-0 win over Cardiff. Here he displays remarkable maturity, slotting home a penalty on the half hour. But soon he'll be displaying those talents before the Stretford end.
Not only Man United, Tottenham's been interested. Norwich was on the same day as Alec came down. Norwich were in for him. But I'm pleased. I wouldn't let him go to anywhere else. There's only probably 4 or 5 clubs that I would have definitely let the lad go to, because I know he'll be well looked after. He'll not go straight into first team football or anything like that. He'll just be coached along, brought along gently, and give the lad his due. He's done marvellous, really.
I spoke to Alex Ferguson. He says they don't want any pressure on me. They just want me to go up there and play and see how I do. So I should be all right.
Who are you looking forward to meeting up there most?
Every one of them. I like all the players up there, I think. It's gonna be good to meet all of them.
There's obviously a danger that you're only 16. There's a danger it might go to your head. Are you worried about that?
No. I think if it starts to go to my head, the apprentices will bring me back down to earth. They had me sweeping the stands on Saturday, so they'll keep my feet on the floor if nobody else does.
Work of it, and nearly suffered another defeat at home on Friday night. Fortunately, this goal by Colchester was disallowed, but Torquay should get another chance tomorrow night when they take on struggling Newport.
Football only by goal difference to winning promotion. A difficult game tonight, away against Tranmere Rovers, who got to the semi-finals at Wembley last week in the Football League Centenary Tournament. Torquay take the squad which thrashed Newport in midweek, plus defender Tom Kelly, who's back from suspension. Well, there could well be some Manchester United fans making the short journey to Tranmere to see the 16-year-old lad who'll join them next month. Well, there was Dave Caldwell, always a willing workhorse, and Lee Sharp on hand for the kill. Then again, Lee Sharp was in the right place for a truly outstanding goal. Then he did the damage from the right wing. And next, he gets the cross in from the left wing, turning the poor old fullback inside out. Amazing to think that lad's just 16, but...
Four. Apprentice winger Lee Sharp, who sat it out on the subs bench at Tranmere on Friday, comes back into the side to face Darlington. And manager Cyril Knowles has now set his side a target of 80 points. Much was made before the game about Cyril Knowles settling old scores by beating the club who'd once rejected him. But it was Darlington who played the more constructive football in the first half. Right winger Alan Roberts looked a particularly tricky customer and nearly made it all the way here after a neat 1-2 with McDonald. But Torquay began to settle down in the second half, and fullback Tom Kelly wasn't that far off the mark with this effort. But there was really too much tension around on both sides. Torquay's 16-year-old star in the making, Lee Sharp, had a quiet game by his recent standards, Darlington having no compunction in chopping him down. Hard luck on the Saint and Greavesy TV crew, who'd come all the way from London to shoot a special on the youngster. Late in the game, United had the perfect chance to score with this through ball to Paul Dobson, but the scything tackle by Dave McCawtrey was cynicism itself, a clear case for a sending off. The resulting free kick was typical of the game itself. Jim McNichol fell down on the job. In the end, it's nearly, but not quite.
So let's have a look at the top of Division 4, is it now?
Promotion, so it was bound to be physical, and Torquay nerves were set jangling early on when Kenny Allen, usually so safe, failed to gather, but John Impey was able to clear the danger. Nearly 4,000 at Plainmoor, but not a lot for them to cheer about. Most good moves seemed to end with the referee's whistle. Many more fouls in the game than shots on target. Dave Caldwell yet again more sinned against than sinning, despite his disciplinary record. A lot of fouls meant a lot of free kicks, and United came close here when Derek Dawkins gave Dave Caldwell a chance, which was well saved by the Darlington keeper. Early in the second half, Darlington had a chance from a set piece. Kenny Allen had it well covered, though. Torquay were willing to push men up. Dave Cole, the centre-back, up for this set piece. Torquay tried hard to work openings. Lee Sharp here spotting Tom Kelly unmarked, but the shot was too high. Hard fought to the end, not always fairly, and not the night for glory, though Derek Dawkins did try to recreate the magic of that cup goal against Tottenham. No score, but United still well placed for promotion.
A Devon firm has been fined a total of five...
Lee Sharp won't be 17 until the end of next month, and as an apprentice at Plainmoor, it's still his job to clean the boots. But next season, he'll be pursuing his trade among the glamour names at Old Trafford. Alex Ferguson has invested what could eventually amount to as much as £100,000 for a winger who's played only a dozen first-team matches for Torquay. It's goals like this that attracted Ferguson's attention. Sharp, who hails from the Midlands but has been at Torquay under the youth training scheme, was the star of the night in his team's recent thrashing of Newport County, scoring two of their six goals. Sharp's form in recent weeks has helped push Torquay towards promotion, and he's hoping that when he departs at the end of the season, they too will be moving on up.
Sharp with a chance to retrieve this. Sharp again, super ball. Must be, yes! Jim McNichol, the scorer, but carved out by Lee Sharp.
Season, we're going to be at Old Trafford, which is a far cry from Torquay here. What was your reaction and how did you come to hear about the move?
I was in bed and the manager came round the house with the secretary and said, would you like to sign for Manchester United? I was just took speechless.
Just like that?
That's just come straight out of the blue. I mean, of course I agreed. I couldn't really turn it down.
Had you had any inkling that they might be interested at that stage?
No, none at all. None at all. It just comes straight out of the blue.
What are your thoughts then on the move to Old Trafford?
Oh, I'm overjoyed. I'm overjoyed. Can't believe it. I'm looking forward to it. I really am.
He's quick. He's got vision, you know, and he's got a good left foot. And I think he'll bring a bit more out of him. I think when he gets with better players, I think he'll even come on more. And that's why I want him to go now, because I feel now, if he goes now, he'll get into good habits. You know, I've seen him in two or three games. He's got a bit of a name now. And I think full-backs, you know, getting that bit tighter on him, and they're not giving him a chance, and he's been clattered once or twice, the lad, and I've taken deep breaths, because we haven't got the money yet. You know, and I don't want anything to happen to the boy. You know, I want to get these four games over and get the boy up there.
Yeah, I've got a lot to learn, and I think Manchester United can teach me the way to play. And I think it's going to be a big help moving there.
Good luck to Lee Sharp. That youth training scheme's worked.
It's also promotion year for the Gulls. It's been a long wait, but Torquay are almost there again.
Thank you, Juliet. The holiday weekend brought six vital points for Torquay, and now the situation is this. They've got two games left. If they win either of those games, they're automatically promoted. The top three go out without having to bother with the playoffs. In fact, two draws would also be enough, and as I'll show you later, even one draw might do the job. Well, the amazing thing is that they've now won more games on their travels than at home. A club record of 11 games. But at home it's been hard work, and Saturday's match against next-to-bottom Carlisle was typical. Just the one goal, and it came before half-time. Dave Caldwell went down after a challenge by Aidan McCaffrey. The referee decided that was a penalty, but Carlisle fans might have felt hard done by. Great joy, though, for the home fans, as Paul Dobson did the necessary. Yeah! Well, early in the second half, Paul Dobson nearly had another. The keeper in all sorts of bother, and Dobson nearly punished him. Off the post and just out of reach for Derek Dawkins. No harm done, though. And Dobson's 22nd goal of the season was worth the 3 points. And, of course, Derek Dawkins made ample amends yesterday when he got...
They faced a five-hour journey north with little prospect of being home before 4 in the morning. Yet somehow 500 managed to get time off work, knowing that a draw tonight ought to be enough and a win would make certain. The players are already in Lancashire and confident that tonight's the night.
Well, they're very confident they're going to do it tonight. You know, we only need a point to make fairly certain, but we want the 3 points tonight to make 100% certain. And the players and manager are confident of doing it.
Many of these supporters have stood loyally on the terraces through the hard times. After an absence of 19 years from Division 3 and 3 seasons at the bottom of the league, who could begrudge them a share in Torquay's impending triumph?
It's a bit of history in the making. It's the first time since I was at grammar school that we've had something to celebrate.
Well, we've been waiting years for a bit of success for Torquay. Now they've got it, so far they've come up.
Do you think they're going to do it tonight?
Yeah, 3-1.
There'll be more celebrating on Saturday after Torquay's final home match. In the meantime, it's all confidence and well-deserved tributes to the manager who's transformed this struggling club in a single season.
Well, somebody else who has made his way up to Burnley is on the other end of the telephone now, I hope. Peter Barraclough. Hello, Pete.
Hello, Sue.
Hello. What is the team news so far?
Well, it's very interesting. We heard Dave Turner mentioning a point would be enough. It may be that Cyril Knowles is also gambling on that, because he was talking to me earlier today about playing three in midfield, and that would mean them leaving out Lee Sharp, of course, sat on the subs bench for the Tranmere game. But Cyril Knowles is just naming a squad, and he won't say what his team is until just before the kickoff.
So he's keeping it a secret. What is the atmosphere like? I mean, are they relaxed?
Yes, they're very relaxed. Of course, they've stayed over since their win over Halifax. I think that put them in very good mood. And they've had a couple of nights in a hotel. They really want to finish it, of course, but it's a very interesting situation. Not too many Torquay fans here for obvious reasons, but I'm sure there's still going to be a tremendous atmosphere.
Well, it is quite a long way, isn't it?
It's a long way, and I was in a traffic jam for an hour and a half, so I hope they get through all right.
Oh, Mike, listen, if they don't win, I mean, if they don't get this 1 point, what happens?
Well, even if they lose tonight, they can still get promotion by beating Scunthorpe on Saturday. And, of course, even if they lost tonight and on Saturday, they're already in the playoffs. So there is everything to play for, as they say.
Lovely. Well, you have a good night, too.
I hope they will.
All right. Thank you very much.
Cheers.
Well, of course, we hope to have a third place in Division 4. Our man at the match was Pete Barraclough.
So a break on here for Burnley.
Steve Taylor in a threatening position, right across the face of the goal, and well cleared away. Well, a terrible ball by Kelly, puts Kenny Allen in trouble. And that's a terrible start for Torquay United. So Burnley take a 1-0 lead here, an awful mistake by Tom Kelly. And in the end, United paying the penalty. Well, that looked to be out, but instead, again, another goal, another mix-up. But no, it's off the goal line, and Kenny Allen absolutely furious with his defence. This could be very dangerous. An open header there. And really, Paul Comstiv should have buried that. Nicol did well there. Oh, well. And the ball falling to Sharp, but just couldn't turn it in. And Burnley exposed really there for the first time. And the final score here at Turf Moor, not the right one, I'm afraid, for Torquay. They lose here by a goal to nil, a well-deserved victory for Burnley. And that means, of course, that Torquay will have to beat Scunthorpe on Saturday to make sure of that place in Division 3 next season.
I thought we froze a wee bit, you know, and I thought I'd let it get. But I thought possibly the goal unsettled us a wee bit. You know, but in saying that, I don't really think we got it together tonight, you know, and set it up for Saturday. We may get a full house Saturday.
Yes, it'll be a crime if there aren't 5,000 there at Playmore.
A win at Burnley last night would have clinched it, but alas, it wasn't to be.
Torquay were under pressure from the very start, and in fact, Burnley went ahead after only 6 minutes. It started with just a speculative long ball forward, and Tom Kelly decided on a long back pass to keeper Kenny Allen. Unfortunately, Sean McGrory got there first. Nearly another Burnley goal, again an unforced error as John Impey tried to screen the ball out of play. McGrory got to it and Phil Lloyd hit the bar trying to clear the danger. No rhythm to Torquay's football, so the manager tried a tactical substitution with Lee Sharp replacing Sean Hazelgrave. And almost immediately, the youngster had Torquay's first real opening, but a good save from Chris Pearce. Sharp with a Torquay corner in the second half, and Paul Dobson's shot kicked off the line. No luck at all for Torquay, as Lee Sharp was just a yard too late. No lack of effort from United, but it seemed the fates had decided that the drama must go into the last game of the season. Torquay against Scunthorpe at Plainmoor on Saturday, and a scriptwriter couldn't have invented a better climax.
And we'll be keeping our fingers crossed. Well, it's time once again. Top five leagues. Here's Dick.
Thanks, Jill. Well, that's to say we'll have Weymouth and Yeovil. Congratulations to Yeovil on a runaway title win in the Vauxhall Opal. Both in the GM Conference, which is often called Division 5 these days. Exeter City in the fourth. Torquay, we hope, in the third. And Argyle safely in the meat of the second division. Argyle are away at Shrewsbury, and the buzz is that Tommy Tynan could be dropped for the first time in his Ham Park career because they're the right way tomorrow.
It's hard to believe, Dick, that it's all going on the last game, you know. It's been a bit nerve-wracking, you know, but hopefully at 20-5 tomorrow, you know, everything will be great.
And yet, I seem to have detected you're a bit depressed. Shortly after you took over, things were perhaps a little worse than you even anticipated.
Well, yeah, they were, really, if I'm honest. And I like to think I'm that, but I mean, really, at the end of the day, I think you've just got to praise the players more than anybody. Because they've got it together, they've battled for each other. And we've literally gone along on probably 15 pros all season. And we're over the 50 mark now, so I mean, a lot of the players deserve a lot of credit.
What, obviously you're having a darn good laugh here this morning. What, obviously there's going to be some pressure. How are you going to handle that in your chat to the lads?
Well, I can only handle it from now until 3 o'clock. And then I think that's when the real pressure starts. And that's when I'll find out, or they'll find out, you know, what pressure's like. Most of these lads have never had that kind of pressure, promotion. I know that, I think probably last season it was a different kind of pressure. You know, and but this is a nicer pressure, I would think. And if we can get that result at 20-5, you know, I mean, it'd be absolutely fantastic for us and everybody, really. You know, I just want to get tomorrow over, because it's been a bit nail-biting all season, and we've kept up there. We haven't been out the top 10. And, I mean, for the senior pros, you know, I mean, they know that they haven't got much time. And I think for them, you know, it'll be a great finish for them, one or two of them. And I'll probably take a bit of stick over that, but never want to know who they are. And you know, I mean, I think this game's come to... It's not the performance. I think it's the result now. And I think it'll be the result tomorrow night, really, what'll matter more than anything. So, just hopefully, at 20-5, the result at Wrexham will have gone our way, and hopefully this one will have gone our way, and we can all celebrate some.
You're not a big drinking man. Might you force something down?
No, I will force something down. Yes, I will.
Good luck,
very much so. Thanks, Steve. Thank you.
Well, amongst the capacity crowd tomorrow. So now it's all down to the playoffs. Two semi-finals on a home and away basis. Rotherham and Swansea in one, Torquay and Scunthorpe in the other. One of those four to go out to the third division. But on Saturday, a capacity crowd at Plainmoor must have thought they'd be spared the agonies of the playoffs. Just 6 minutes into the game, and Torquay were a goal down. Ian Richardson against the post, Andy Flounders into the net. An equally bad start to the second half. Tony Dawes from the throw-in, across to the far post, and a fine goal by Ian Richardson, with Kenny Allen blaming his defence. Bolton were only drawing at Wrexham at that time, so Scunthorpe thought they were on their way up. They survived a penalty appeal there when John Impey was clearly pushed to the ground, but the referee wasn't impressed. Impey took a knock and went off later. Well, Torquay did have their chances, but their finishing just wasn't right on the day. One enormous run from Derek Dawkins, almost the length of the pitch, and with the defence backpedalling, but a bad bobble as he shot cost him power and accuracy. Some of the crowd thought that was in, even so. Another penalty appeal by Torquay. Roger Gibbons had his legs absolutely scythed away, but the referee, again, wasn't impressed. Some Torquay players lucky not to be booked as the referee was jostled, but they did get a penalty when Paul Dobson went down. Not as clear-cut, perhaps, as the other two incidents, but the crowd had heard that Bolton were a goal up at Wrexham. Torquay had to get this penalty plus a second goal. Well, Torquay couldn't get a second to go with Paul Dobson's penalty. Clearly a bitterly disappointed Cyril Knowles as he spoke to David Willis.
It's a couple of days to get over it, and then we've got to get back into the swing of it for next Sunday. But it's just one of those things, you know. I mean, if we hadn't created anything and we hadn't had any chance, then we've got to go back to the drawing board. But we just didn't put the chance away what we had.
Is it going to be a battle for you getting morale and spirits up after two defeats?
I don't know, really. I mean, we'll come in Tuesday, we'll start all over again. I mean, what can you do? I mean, there's nothing you can't change the result. You've just got to accept the result, and that's it.
Are you going to get up to the third division?
Oh, dear me, do me a favour. I mean, I'd like to get up today and gone off next week on holiday, but just have to cancel it and start again.
So the first leg of the playoffs will be at Plainmoor next...
Striker Dave Caldwell was taken to hospital, although he will be fit for Wednesday's semi-final playoff. There were several other incidents too. Pete Barraclough has the details.
No mad dogs, but plenty of Englishmen gathered in the noonday sun to witness the effects of 70-degree temperatures and an overlong season on 22 players and one referee. Perhaps that blow on the head explains some of Tony Ward's decisions. This the first of his six bookings in the match, although Paul Dobson can have no complaints there. Torquay took a well-deserved lead just under the half-hour when Dave Caldwell nodded home a pinpoint corner from Lee Sharp. United desperate for as many goals as possible to take to Scunthorpe for Wednesday's second leg. But that only served to raise the temperature. Caldwell fouled here by Scunthorpe centre-back Paul Nicol. But to be fair, it was hardly a sending-off offence. Perhaps Tony Ward felt the need to assert his authority. The Scunthorpe, down to 10 men, conceded a second goal minutes later when Impey laid on a perfect ball to Dobson, who neatly tucked it home. So Torquay 2-0 up and apparently coasting to an easy win. Delight for the 4,000 fans. In fact, Torquay provided the best football of the match early in the second half, with Lee Sharp showing some of the delicate skills soon to be enjoyed by the Old Trafford faithful. But Paul Dobson really should have scored here and put the match beyond doubt. But having been let off the hook, Scunthorpe rallied well. Lister unlucky to see this goal disallowed for a dubious offside decision, again from Tony Ward. And that only increased the frustration which boiled over in an ugly incident involving Torquay manager Cyril Knowles. Dave Colwell was stretchered off after yet another off-the-ball incident, and Knowles came on to remonstrate in true Mike Gatting style. In the end, the Torquay boss himself was sent off, his anger barely concealed. And he'll still be seething over this Scunthorpe goal, which could prove costly. Kenny Allen dropping Taylor's shot at the feet of the grateful Alan Flounders. Well, Torquay and Scunthorpe meet yet again at the old showground on Wednesday. Referee Tony Ward must be relieved he won't be in charge.
Oh, we'll be following that match, of course. Well, now let's catch up with some more of today's...
Booked, one sent off, and Torquay's manager ordered off the pitch. Well, the goal action started midway through the first half.
28 minutes gone. Sharp's corner, Caldwell's goal. Four minutes before half-time, Scunthorpe were down to 10 men as Paul Nicol was sent off for this challenge on Dave Caldwell. The previous game between these teams was hard. This was worse. The crowd anticipated the sending off and celebrated. Doubly so when Torquay scored again. A great through ball from John Impey, and Paul Dobson did well to control it. 2-0, right on half-time. Halfway through the second half, Tom Kelly pointed out that Dave Caldwell had been floored off the ball. Number five then kicked Caldwell's head, which was certainly seen by Derek Dawkins, if not by the ref. John Impey had no doubt either, and tempers ran high. Cyril Knowles, the Torquay manager, added his protest, and the referee then ordered him from the pitch. Meanwhile, Dave Caldwell was carried off. Another blow for Torquay almost immediately when Kenny Allen dropped a long-range shot for Andy Flounders to tap in a simple goal, one which could be very costly. If at full-time on Wednesday at Scunthorpe the aggregate scores are level, it's extra time with away goals counting double.
Cricket.
It's this mistake by Torquay goalkeeper Kenny Allen in Sunday's first leg which could be so costly. United were coasting to a 2-0 win at the time, but that piece of Flounders opportunism has given the Lincolnshire side an away goal which could come into the reckoning in the event of a stalemate. If Scunthorpe are leading 1-0 at the end of 90 minutes, there'll be extra time. After that, away goals will count double.
We know what to expect, and I think I've got the lads wound up, and hopefully everything will go well. I mean, we're 1-0 up, you know, they need two. So, I mean, the lads are, well, they're on the toes, hopefully.
Well, the good news for United fans is that tearaway striker Dave Colwell will be leading the attack tonight, despite being stretchered off on Sunday following a blow to the throat.
Well, we'll just go out there, do our best and get stuck in, and I hope we get a result.
Well, certainly your away form this season has been magnificent, so that obviously puts you in good heart.
Yeah, it's been a real turnaround for the lads. Some of the lads that were here last year when they were down and out. And to be in this position this year, I think they realise what they've done for the club. And I think we can still go on further.
Well, if Torquay do win the tie, they'll play either Rotherham or Swansea in next week's final.
Torquay ahead with 10 minutes to go. But what should have been a comfortable closing period became a cliffhanger following a controversial penalty decision.
Even the Scunthorpe players looked surprised when the referee gave a penalty for handball. Steve Lister's shot wasn't well hit, but it levelled the scores on the night and gave Torquay an anxious 10 minutes until the final whistle, when they could celebrate and look ahead to next Wednesday's first leg of the final at Swansea. The second leg will be on Saturday week at Plainmoor, when Torquay hope to return to the third division after a gap of 16 years.
But last night's game has certainly thrown the whole tie wide open, and we can expect an explosive second leg at Plainmoor on Saturday if the match at the Vetch Field is anything to go by. Well, Torquay gave an inspired performance in the first half, producing some of the best football of the match. In fact, this was the best move of the match.
Dobson onto Hasselgrave. Lovely ball to Mark Loram. He had a piece of luck, but Derek Dawkins storming into the area. A very good shot indeed. In fact, Dawkins has had a marvellous run in the playoffs and very unlucky not to score here early in that first half. Good save by Guthrie, the Swansea goalkeeper. But in fact, it was Swansea who opened the scoring with just 15 minutes to go in the match. A beautifully worked set piece engineered by the veteran Robbie James. Through ball to Chris Coleman. And a good header there from Sean McCarthy, his sixth goal in six matches. Superb cross that from Coleman, but look at the way that McCarthy jumps. He'll have to be watched at Playmore on Saturday. But Torquay only have themselves to blame for Swansea's second goal, which came minutes later. And Torquay defence standing right off and allowing Swansea to play. Again, Robbie James very much involved. He's well into his 30s now, but still a very good player. Lovely ball there to Rayner, the cross into the centre, and it's the substitute Ian Love who heads home there. Very good goal that by Swansea, and that of course was the killer blow for Torquay. Superb ball through the two Torquay defenders there onto Rayner, and the cross just about perfect for Love to head home. So Torquay 2-0 down with just 4 minutes to go. It looked a killer blow, no arguments about that one. But then came Jim McNichol's all-important goal in the closing stages. Gardner's throw-in. It's knocked in there by Tom Kelly. A real tussle in the goal mouth. Guthrie involved there, and it's McNichol who gets the header. Now, that, of course, resulted in some incidents, and unfortunately, we've seen too many of those in the playoff. Let's hope there's no repeat of that in the second leg on Saturday.
Will they, won't they? We'll see on Saturday.
It's going to be a hard-fought game. And Saturday's return leg at Plainmoor is now very finely balanced as Torquay kept their deficit to just one goal.
Swansea's biggest crowd of the season at nearly 11,000, but they were kept pretty quiet by Torquay's stern defence, which dominated the first half, which ended at no score. Torquay were very unlucky not to score from a corner in the 63rd minute when Paul Dobson's shot came down and away off the crossbar. Then came Swansea's first goal with 16 minutes of the game left. Clearly a rehearsed set piece with Robbie James, the skipper, waiting for the fullback to take the pass down the line, and Sean McCarthy got the far post header. Worse to come as Swansea scored again with only 6 minutes left. A nice build-up with Robbie James again prominent. He made the opening before feeding Paul Rayner, and the cross was buried by substitute Ian Love. 2-0 down and Torquay in trouble. But in the last minute, a long throw into the box and Jim McNichol got his head to the ball to make the deficit just one goal. Some ugly incidents followed, which one hopes will not be continued as a vendetta on Saturday, but it's going to be tense and it's going to be hard.
With Chelsea Flush.
For nearly 11,000 at the Vetch Field to see Swansea take the lead against Torquay. Sean McCarthy's powerful header. It was a good build-up to the second Swansea goal. Robbie James, number six, started it. Paul Rayner, number 10, carried it on. Ian Love finished it off. That was 2-0. Well, they've known great days at Swansea, and they're beginning to feel that perhaps there's something of the old glory returning. But late in the game, Torquay struck back. Jim McNichol's goal, but the aftermath ended the game with a nasty taste.
Yes, an unpleasant incident, that.
After 28 minutes and 4-1 behind on aggregate, they storm back with two Jim McNichol-headed goals to make it 2-2 and 4-3 on aggregate in the 39th minute. Though Swansea scored a third before half-time, the second 45 minutes belonged almost exclusively to Torquay. Dave Caldwell-headed goal in the 67th minute levelled the score, but Swansea won 5-4 on aggregate. Cricket and Somerset.
Well, hello to you. Welcome to Promotion or Bust. We're here at Playmore for the second leg of the final playoff match to get promotion between Torquay United and Swansea. The winners, of course, over two legs are short of that place in Division 3 next season. It's the climax of what's been a remarkable season of transformation for Torquay under their manager Cyril Knowles, when you consider that just over a year ago we were here when they were playing Crewe on the last match of the season. They just survived in the Football League by the skin of their teeth, all thanks to police dog Bryn and, of course, that last gasp winner by Paul Dobson over Crewe. But what a different story it's been this year in Division 4. That's the table as it finished up after the 46 games. Wolves, Cardiff and Bolton all getting automatic promotion. Torquay really should have been up there with them, but as it was, they were left to fight it out with Swansea, Scunthorpe and Rotherham for that promotion place. Well, they did very well in the semi-finals, winning over two legs against Scunthorpe. So, of course, they went into that final against Swansea at the Vetch,